Good morning, everyone. Welcome to church. We're so glad that you chose to be here this morning. We're going to sing some songs, so why don't you stand with me? Put your hands together and sing this out. At East Point this morning. We're going to sing a couple more songs. We'll hear a message from Pastor Tony, and then we'll get you home. And, this morning I was thinking about singing together as a church and how sometimes it might feel kind of weird. Like we come all together and we're just singing together. And why do we do that? And You know, I just wanted to encourage you this morning that we're singing about how good God is, and God doesn't really care if you sound good. He doesn't really care if you're on perfect pitch or have it all together. You know, yesterday we were at Disney on Ice. I have an almost one-year-old little girl, and we took her to Disney on Ice, and the whole time I didn't watch the show. I watched her. My focus was just so on her because she was singing and dancing and clapping, and it was so cute. And that filled my heart with so much joy. And I was thinking this morning, the way that I feel about my little girl in that moment is how God feels about you when you sing to him. He doesn't care if it's put together. He doesn't care if you're clapping off beat or just singing so out of tune. Just you being you and singing to him and about him fills his heart with joy. And so this morning, as we continue to sing, I want you to think about that. Let go of whatever you came in here with that might be holding you back from singing to him this morning. And let's just sing knowing that God just wants you. Let's sing.
Jesus, precious Lord, none on the earth or heaven above that I have found more beautiful. You are my treasure, my great reward. I just wanna move your It's all I wanna do. I just wanna stand in awe and pour my love on you, no matter how much the cost. I freely give it all to you, all to you.
Cause I just wanna move your heart.
Sing this out. My hope is built. Jesus, we love you and thank you that we get to come together and sing about how great you are and what you have done for us, how you've changed our life. Thank you, Lord, that when we have trials, when we have storms in our life, Lord, we know that we can call on you and that you are going to be the same, that you are a strong foundation for us to put our hope in, Lord. We love you and thank you for who you are. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for singing. Epic middle school and high school students, if you want to join our youth group today, you can head to the back. There's a leader there. And everyone else, go ahead and take a seat.
Well, good morning. Welcome to East Point. My name is Tony, and I have the privilege of being one of the pastors on the team here, and I am thrilled that you're with us. If you're you're probably not saying anything, but if you're watching online, I'm glad you're here with us as well. I hope that you'll stick through the whole service today, because I actually think whether you're online or in person, that this is going to be a great message for us. It's going to challenge us and help us take some practical steps of faith as we continue to discover who Jesus is and how he's leading our lives. In fact, maybe you're here today and you're just kicking the tires of faith. You're not sure what you believe or why you believe it. Someone invited you and you're here. You've been coming for a while because you're just exploring the idea of Jesus. Is Jesus who he claimed to be? And I'm just thrilled that you're here with us. And I want you to know that East Point has always been and will always be. We're committed to being a safe place where you can find and follow Jesus, where you can kick the tires of your faith and consider the claims and we give you the freedom to do that at your own pace. We're not going to make you do anything, and we just promise we're not going to do anything weird along the way too. So we're glad that you're here with us. We've been doing a series for a few weeks now called They Walk Before Us, and we've been taking a look at some Old Testament figures of people of great faith. These are, if you've been a follower of Jesus for any length of time, you've probably heard of a few of these people that have been really heroes in the Christian faith. And we've learned from them, and we've been looking at really how each one of them kind of have this before and after work of God that takes place in their life, where we learn and we look up to them because of their great feats of faith and their obedience and what God does when they trust in God, when they put their faith in God, and we kind of see this before and after. And I know for me, and I know for you, that we all have this transformation that takes place of our life when you begin to follow Jesus, and this transformation that starts to happen. For me, I can remember back when I was a teenage kid, 13, 14 years old, that made a decision to follow Jesus. And by the time I'm 16, I'll tell you what, my life looked completely different. That's kind of what we're going to uncover today as we look at the before and after work of God in our lives as we wrap up this series. So today we're not going to look back just at an Old Testament figure. We're actually going to consider it in this way. If people were telling your story, your They Walk Before Us story, what would they say about you? If they were telling about you, would your life, would the characteristics that describe you, would those come out in a way that you're proud of, that other people would look up to? They'd tell the story of you when you walked before them. And I'm going to start by telling a story today, because I think God really laid the groundwork for all of this, and this reality that transformation is just like a normal part of life. And in fact, there's a story of a chess champion that's from Europe, and he's not just a chess champion, he's also kind of an art connoisseur. And one day, it's his day off, he finds himself visiting a local art gallery, kind of a back alley art gallery, kind of off the main path, not too busy. And he's just traveling the hallways, admiring the different art that's in the room. And there's one piece that specifically catches his attention. The title of the painting is Checkmate. And so as a chess champion, he's like, what is this? And the painting is a painted picture of a chess game, only in this chess game, on one side of the board is Satan, and he's sitting back with a sinister grin on his face, just tapping the table with his fingers, thinking, I got you right where I want you. And on the other side of the table is this young man, and he's sitting there, and you could just see fear on his face, and there's a bead of sweat drenching his brow, and he's nervous as can be, and he's just lost the game. And the chess champion, he's looking at the painting though, and he's examining the board. And, you know, he's like, and he's seen Queen's Gambit, so he knows what he's doing. And but he's examining the board, and he looks at it, and he's just, for about 30 minutes, he studies it, looking at all the possibilities of how did they get to this spot and what could happen from here. And then a janitor actually comes by in the background, and he stops and says, "Sir, do you happen to have an old chess board?" And the janitor said, "You know what, I think we might. Let me go check." And then he brings out a chessboard back to the chess champion, and the chess champion takes that chessboard and he sets it up on the floor between him and the painting. And he takes the board and he takes out some pieces and he's looking at the painting, he's looking at the board, and he's just looking and setting another piece, looking and setting another piece, and he's setting it up as an exact replica of what he sees in the painting. So this goes here, okay, yep. Here's this, that's D7. I don't know what the numbers mean, but that's But he's just setting it up just like you can see on the painting there. And he's examining this. And he's just, at every piece that he puts down, he realizes like how they got to this spot. And as he then kind of just sits back and he looks at the board. And then with a big smile and a grin on his face, he just sits back. He's like, and in this seemingly abandoned art gallery, he says to the picture, he's like, "Young man, if you could hear me, I sure wish you could hear me right now. I sure wish you could see what I see. Because if you could hear me right now, it would not only allow you to, I've got a move for you to make. There is a move you can make that if you could just hear me and you could just make this move, it would not only deliver you from defeat, it would also lead you to an ultimate victory. Young man, if you could just hear me right now." You see, the devil thinks that he's got this young man, but there's one final move that could be made. The devil thinks he's got him in checkmate. He's got him right where he wants him. He wins, but there's one final move that could be made, but the young man doesn't see it. And the chess champion, as he's pieced it all together, he knows. And the thing is when you look at scripture and you open up the Bible, what the chess champion sees in this picture is also kind of a narrative of what we see throughout scripture. It's this back and forth, move, counter move between God and people, God and Satan, God and this enemy that lives, that's very real and present in our everyday world. And so this chess champion sees what we've actually seen all throughout scripture. So let's just look at it, okay? So just follow me here. In the beginning of time, God created angelic beings. He created them for his glory. One of them was named Lucifer. And Lucifer, he wanted to share in the glory of God. And that was a big no-no. That's reserved for God. And so Lucifer rebels against God and took a third of his angels with him, his buddies with him in his rebellion. God decided not to rid himself of Lucifer and his cohorts, and he decided to create a lesser being called man. And this lesser being, lesser than the angels, would be designed to show what God could do through a lesser person, a lesser being, a lesser creature that was dependent on him over a greater creature that was in rebellion against him. And this leads then to the angelic conflict. Lucifer, whose name is now Satan, has rebelled against God, and the cosmic chess game has begun to unfold. Satan takes his turn, and he actually manipulates the words of God in the garden with Adam and Eve. He manipulates them to persuade Adam and Eve to take control for their own gain. And now it's God's turn to move on the cosmic chessboard, and he sacrifices animals to make a covering for Adam and Eve to lift them of their shame. And that's when Satan responds by getting Cain to kill Abel, and he tries to rid the universe of this godly line so that Genesis 3:15 could never come true. But that's when God again moves on the cosmic chessboard by allowing Eve to become pregnant, and it says that the name of God was again heard on the lips of men. But that's when Satan gets the entire known world to rebel against God through the influence of his demons. And that's then God takes his turn on the cosmic chessboard, and he gets a man named Noah, and he says, "Noah, I want you to build a boat on dry ground during the day. And then at night, you can print out these tracts with a 3-word sermon that says, 'It's gonna rain,' and go ahead and hand them out to everybody." And God then brings judgment on the world, but he saves this one family. And of course, then, that's when Satan responds by getting a man named Nimrod, who then builds two civilizations, one of Assyria, one of Babylon. And he brings the two together, these civilizations, and they're operating independently of God, centralized around a religious ziggurat tower, otherwise known as the religion of man, otherwise known as humanism. And that's when God then takes his turn and goes, and he causes all of the nations to, he scatters their languages. They can't communicate anymore. God then goes on the offense, and he goes down to a city named Ur, and he finds a man named Abraham, and he says, hey, through you, I'm going to build a great nation. And that's when Satan responds and takes his turn, and he gets the descendants of Abraham, this great nation, to be in slavery for 400 years in Egypt under the Pharaoh. But that's when God responds by going to Midian and finding a man named Moses. And he says, hey, Moses, go set my people free. And of course, that's when Satan responds. And now Israelite has their backs up against the Red Sea and Pharaoh's army is moving in. But then that's when God, of course, responds by opening up the Red Sea and God's people get across on dry ground. Listen, it seems to me that the entire Old Testament is move and countermove, move and countermove, move, countermove, move, counter. It's just this back and forth chess game between Satan and God. This back and forth. Satan moves, God responds. Satan responds to God's move, and it keeps on going. By the end of the Old Testament, we have what looks to be a tie. In fact, for 400 years, there just seems to be silence. There's nothing new happening. It's like they're both just looking back at the table, figuring out nothing has worked so far. I can't outwit them. They keep coming back on both sides. And when we flip the pages into the New Testament, evidently it's God's turn to move, because scripture says that so-and-so begat so-and-so, who begat so-and-so, and gave birth to Joseph. Joseph marries Mary, and Mary gives birth to Jesus. And now Jesus enters into human history. Up until this point, God has always done something through someone or some people. And this time, God's like, I'm sick of this mess. I'm going to come down there and I'm going to kick his butt myself. And so Jesus enters into human history. And at that moment, Satan steps back and he's like, ah, what do I do? What move should I make? What? And he's just pondering the board. He's looking at all the possible scenarios. He's like, I got it. I've got it this time. I know what I'm going to do. He says, I'm going to get Jesus arrested. I'm going to get Jesus illegally tried. I'm going to get Jesus nailed to a cross and die. Gotcha, checkmate. And Satan just steps back and just got him right where I want him. Only some of you know the story, and you know that's not the final move. And you know enough of the story to know that while Jesus was dead on Friday, stayed dead on Saturday, the tomb was empty on Sunday. Mary runs to the tomb just before daybreak. There's an angel there holding a sign that says, hashtag, he ain't here, right? God made the final move. Jesus Christ was risen from the dead and was victorious over death. I would have loved to have been there that day. If you could see like a physical Satan with the expression on his face, like, what? How did this happen? How did we get, like, and he's replaying the movie. Okay, I did that, and he did that. Like, this wasn't supposed to be. I never saw this. How did we get here? You were dead. You were dead. How did this happen? To which Jesus responds in Revelation 1:18, and he does his best Adele impersonation when he says, hello from the other side. Jesus loved Adele. He wasn't a good singer, but he loved, I was dead, but now alive. Like, it was just, he gotcha. You thought you want, see, here's the thing, is that my goal today is not to just convince you or try to convince you that Jesus is who he said he was, but I truly want for each one of us that we would have an encounter with a God, that we'd understand there's a God that just so desperately wants to be in relationship with you, that he came to earth to take the final move, that he wants to be in your life, that he loves you, and that you can have relationship and experience this life-giving God. The single most important part, for me, this story is the foundation for my faith. Because people try to poke holes in a lot of the scripture, you can say, Jesus' miracles, they were staged, they weren't real, they were embellished, it's legend, okay. The virgin birth, I can't get behind that. The Old Testament literal translation of the creation account, I can't get there, I don't know, okay, fine. Okay, let's shelf all of that for a second. But to deny the fact that there was a physical human being named Jesus who claimed a whole bunch of stuff about himself, he walked before us, claimed all these things about himself, and then he was put to death on a cross. He was dead on Saturday and alive on Sunday. And never before in history and never again in human history has this happened since, that someone claims to be God and actually is put to death and rises again. It's the foundation of for me as a young 13, 14-year-old kid. This allows me to say, okay, there's something to this. And for me, my journey begins at that point, recognizing there's a God that loves us, that came to the world, that died for us, and that also lives again for us. And he invites us into this new life that we have in him. And as a 13, 14-year-old kid, I began to experience new life. Before Jesus, my life looked like a mess. I was making moves in all sorts of directions with no aim, no target, no purpose. Did you know that about 80% of people, statistically, 80% of people go through life every day feeling like they don't know their purpose? But I'll tell you what, by the time I was 15, 16, 17 years old, I felt like I have a purpose. I have an aim in my life. What used to be just a train wreck waiting to happen is now on a trajectory to a life of fulfillment, a life of value, a life of purpose as I began to follow Jesus. And so I want to invite you, and some of you are already living this out, but there's still more work to be done because we're never finished. We're never complete. I want to invite you into the before and after work of God. Now, we love a good before and after story, don't we? We just do. Like any HGTV fans, okay, we used to watch this a lot in our house. We actually live in a tiny home, okay? Fun fact about Tony. We live in 360 square feet with five of us and a dog. But we watched all the, we got inspired by these Tiny House Nation shows. And so we did it. We said, let's build our own tiny home. And now we live that. But some of you watch like Property Brothers, Fixer Upper, Urban Oasis, all these certain ones. And did you know that according to HGTV, this is nuts, okay? According to HGTV, you can like work at Starbucks 1.5 days a week and chase butterflies for a living, and you have a $1.8 million home budget. Like, it's crazy, but that's just the way it is, right? On HGTV, it's stupid, really. It's not real, but we watch these shows because we love a good before and after story. How many of you have ever tried a fitness challenge and you take pictures of yourself, your physique before? And so we love this stuff because we love transformation. So you take a picture that looks like this and you're like, okay, there's some work to be done, right? There's some work to be done, but then 7-minute abs for 7 days. And guess what happens? Boom. I look like that. Anyone can do it. Anyone can do it, right? We love that before and after transformation story. Remember before Google? Before Google, so if you're a high school or middle school, you don't know what that, before Google, that there's a time before Google when like you could win any argument, but just by being committed and passionate enough, right? You're like, you know that you know that you know. But after Google, like I haven't won an argument in my house for like 10 years. Because it turns out my wife can read and I'm just wrong a lot, okay? Because she can just Google it and like, yeah, you know, and I'm just wrong. Like there's a before and after. When you get married, there's a before and after. If you're single, maybe you're engaged, you might not realize this yet, but us married people, we know that there's a before and after that happens when you're married. Things change, they just do. Before you're married and you go out on a date, right, you set this up. It's, okay, next Friday, we're gonna go on a date. I'm gonna make reservations. I'm gonna get off work early so I can get my hair did, and I'm gonna just be all ready to go, right? That's just, we set ourselves up for success on this date. It's special. We make a special arrangement for this whole thing. After you get married, what's it look like? Oh, it's Friday. What do you wanna do tonight? Let's just stay in. Okay, sounds good, right? It's just different. It's a before and after. Before you get married, you go on that date and you get out, you open the door for her, right? You close it behind her, you go inside, you open the door, you pull out her chair, you let her sit first. Like all, you just honor, and just do. After you get married, you jump out of the car, you're walking in, she's still in there. Are your arms broken? Like, what's the deal? Like, let's go. Come on. Food's waiting. You know, it just changes before and after. And then you go into that restaurant and it's like your favorite Mexican restaurant. Only this time you ate something that's a little too spicy. And this is before you're married and it's just not sitting right with you. And you got her in the car and you're going home. You're going to drop her off. And you're just thinking, dear God, if there is a God in heaven, I need your help right now because there's just a rumble. And you're like, how fast can I get her home and get her out of this car, okay? Because you would never imagine, before you're married, you never imagine maybe releasing anything in the car. But after you're married, you get done with dinner, you get her in the car, you lock the door, lock the window, you know, like, just let her go. Because you're married, right? She's stuck with you, okay? There is a before and after work that goes on, okay? HGTV, before and after, it makes great television, but that's really not how life is experienced. And the truth is that every single person that we've looked at during this series has a before and after work. So as we learn from them through the scriptures, we've looked at some, like, before they trusted or before they walked in obedience, before they had faith, and then what happens because of that faith or because of that obedience. There is a move, and there's a counter move, and then they overcome that move, and then there's another counter move, and it just keeps going back and forth. You obviously can tell I don't know how to play chess. I'm moving the same colors twice in a row. But that's what happens. Is this move and counter move? Move and counter move. You take two steps or a step forward only to feel like you're taking two steps back. Don't we feel like that sometimes? We're like, things are going our way, and then they're not. And then they're not, and then they're not, and then it just gets piled on sometimes. We take a move to try to bust free, and then it's not going our way again. Here's the thing in life is that what we find to be true about the people we've looked at in Scripture, we already know to be true about ourselves, is that while we make strides and take steps forward, there are things in our life, some in our control, some outside of our control, that want to counter our moves and take us backwards. Right, we all have a desire to achieve some level of success, to achieve good things, to be happy in life. And that might look different for varying people on a different scale, but we have this desire that things maybe, if they're bad now, we don't want them to be bad. We want them to be better. But what are the moves and the steps that we're willing to take in order for us to get there? And here's the big idea for today, and it's in your notes. In fact, if you're a writer downer or texting your phone, I would encourage you, put this somewhere that you'll see it. Because I think it's important. Here's the big idea for today is that everybody ends up somewhere, okay? Everybody ends up somewhere. Very few people end up there on purpose. Everybody, we got the same amount of hours in the day. We're all doing something with our life. Some of us are purposely living every moment. Some of us are workaholics and we forsake our family. Some of us are squandering our time. We all end up somewhere. Very few people end up there on purpose. Would we be intentional about the steps that we're taking to get to where we want to go? And here's what I believe and where I've placed my hope is that God is doing a before and after work in me and in you and to those around us. Can you remember your life before you started following Jesus? Maybe you grew up in church and you really can't. You're like, church, Jesus has always been part of my life. I've always been, like, I remember as a little, you know, as a kid, a baby, like you accepted Christ and you began to follow. And so it's hard to imagine, but you maybe have strayed and you've wandered or things have been difficult. And so you've taken the reins to your life and you've tried to do it your own way and you saw how that didn't work out. Can you remember a time in your life or before you started following Jesus and what life looked like and the transformation that happens as we begin to turn our life over to him and follow him and walk in faith and walk in obedience to the things that he's doing in us? What did your relationships look like before Jesus? What did your marriage, your parenting, your finance, your career choices, what did all that, and how has God reshaped and transformed or brought purpose and value into your life, the before and after? And I think all of us have an after picture that we paint for ourselves. Here's where I want to be. Here's the me I want to be. Here's who, if I could have it my way, if I could control things, this is what life would look like. And maybe that's just the next season for you. Maybe you're single and you want to be married. Maybe you're in college and you want your career. Maybe you're married and you have kids and you want them out of the house. Maybe whatever. But you have a picture of what you want for your future. We call that your preferred future, the after picture. And the thing is, that picture is perfect. It looks great. It probably could go in a magazine. But the problem with it is that very few of us will ever achieve six-pack abs and six-figure incomes, okay? That might not be in the cards for you. It is for me, obviously, but it's not for all of us. My mom laughs too hard when I make jokes like that, okay? But we have an after picture, and we want that, and yet it's something that we'll often never achieve. But here's the thing is that we're looking at this picture perfect after image of what we want for our life. But I don't think that God is calling us to be perfect as much as he's calling us to make progress. And here's the point here. The truth is that progress is greater than perfection. Which if you can grasp that, that's a really freeing concept, because some of us feel the weight of perfection that we don't even want to do, we don't even want to try if we can't already know that it's going to happen the way we want it to happen. And it almost paralyzes us. We don't take a step of faith or walk in obedience because it might be out of our control or it might not go the way that we want to go. So why go at all? Perfection is not the goal. Progress is progress. As a follower of Jesus, progress is this. Progress is the continual steps to becoming more like Jesus. That's what it is, that we're called to share. The invitation is to become more like Jesus. In fact, some of the first century leaders in the early church were people like Peter, and Peter says this. Peter says, this is the kind of life that you've been invited into, the kind of life that Christ lived. That's the life. We can learn from the life of Jesus and just live that type of life. Paul says in Galatians, he says, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control. Let me ask you, how are you doing with that? How's that going for you? If you're here and you're a follower of Jesus, are those the types of fruits that your life is bearing? Could people come and pick that fruit off you? That's what fruit is, right? Fruit is something we can consume off a tree, off a plant. Could people come and they're like, wow, that person has love and peace and patience and kindness. How are you doing with that? If you're not a follower of Jesus, maybe you weigh yourself or judge yourself on a different scale because you don't look at the life of Jesus and say, that's my aim, that's my target. But think about this. If you are a follower of Jesus, there's other people in the room and in your life that are looking at you, and would they identify the fruit of Jesus in your life? How are you doing with that? Who's the person that you're wanting to become? What steps, what moves are you needing to make in order to become that person? What goals do you have for your life? In fact, here's a question I want you to think about. What stands between you and your goals? What stands between you from making the move that you would like to make in order to get to become closer to the person that you really want to be, the person that maybe God has designed you to be? And I'm not just talking about like achievements, accolades, trophies that you can put on a shelf. I'm talking about things that are actually probably more important. Things like your attributes and your virtues, the way people describe you, the way people tell your story. A word that's often thrown around with this would be the word legacy. What legacy are you leaving? Another way we could say it would be, if someone was telling your they walked before us story, what would they say? What would they say about you and the life that you lived and the kind of fruit that you bore? What would they say about you? And so we have dreams and aspirations and goals. We have an after picture in mind. What's keeping you from becoming that person? There's some really common things that I think keep us from these goals. Often there's things just simply like inexperience. Some of us experience fear. We get polarized or paralyzed by fear, hesitations. There's sometimes just poor time management or a lack of resources. And these are true. There are obstacles that we're going to face, hurdles that we have to get over. We make a move, and then there's a counter move. It's part of life. It's what happens. And the reality is God, Scripture says that Jesus come that you may have life and life to the full. But what's the enemy's role? He wants to steal, kill, and destroy, and he's making your life harder when you allow him to, and sometimes even when you don't, but you have another move to take. For many of us, the biggest problem that kind of keeps us from our goals and becoming that person is actually, we almost self-sabotage, and you might not have thought about this before, but think about it. We're too smart, like, because we know all the right things up here, but it doesn't mean that we do the right things. Right, we know up here what we want to do, but it doesn't mean that we do it. We know how to follow Jesus. We know what it looks like to bear fruit. We memorized a long time ago as kids the 9 fruits of the Spirit. We know. It's like, it would be like this, like you're driving to work one day and you're like, okay, I really want to be more patient. God, I need to work on my patience. And so that means that I'm going to stay calm and I'm going to listen before I speak. And I have an important meeting today and I know that their tensions could be high, but I'm going to just take a deep breath before I react to my boss or that colleague, and you're driving and you're like, I'm gonna be patient. And then all of a sudden some Honda Sonata just cuts you off and you forget everything you know because you wanna let them know that they're number one, right? Like, and so we know oftentimes, but it doesn't translate to do. We know, but we don't do. In fact, I'd bet there's a bunch of you that have been around church for a while that you don't need another sermon, you don't need another book, you don't need another blog or podcast or Instagram post or you don't need any of that because you already know enough about the life of Jesus that you could keep you busy for the rest of your life just trying to walk in obedience to that Jesus-like life. You don't need another sermon. You don't need another book. You just need to do the things that you already know. And sometimes we self-sabotage. Like, we know, but we don't do. So we know, but we don't do. Knowing is easy, and doing is difficult. Knowing's easy, doing is difficult. In fact, listen to what the Apostle Paul writes to some of the first Jesus followers in the city of Corinth in the first century. He says, don't you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize. So run to win. Remember that. So run to win. All athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away, but we do it for an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. I am not just shadow boxing. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Now, you're smart. I can tell. You look smart. You know what a race is, what it really boils down to. Besides the track that you run on, the trail, the guy, you know, what a race really boils down to is just taking one foot and putting it in front of the other, you know, as fast as you can, for as long as you can to win the race, right? But that's what it really boils down to is just step after step after step after step, stride after stride after stride after stride. And so we take steps in that direction. So you have a preferred future. You have an after picture of what you want for your life. For me, I have an after picture, and I know I'm not there yet, but hey, if I keep taking step after step after step, guess what I'm doing? I'm making progress. I'm getting closer. I'm living into the value that I can add to life. I'm experiencing purpose. I'm experiencing joy. I'm experiencing fulfillment as I take step after step after step. But you know what sometimes keeps us from taking steps? You know what sometimes keeps us from stepping forward? Sitting. This feels nice. This is more comfortable. This is easier. And you know what I can do when I'm sitting? I can watch Netflix. I can scroll my phone. I can play a video game. And sometimes we take an easy road. Instead of making a move that you know is the right move for you to make, you just sit back and you do nothing. And we fail to make progress. And we make excuses, right? You got all sorts of excuses of why you're not the person you hope to become. Right? And you know what they say about excuses. They're like belly buttons. We've all got them. They all stink. Right? You're not sure? Try it. We make excuses. When's the last time you had a goal for yourself that you didn't achieve? When's the last time that you're like, I want to be this type of man or this type of woman or this type of mom or dad? And you didn't achieve it. And the thing is, again, and sometimes we think we have to be perfect. Newsflash, you're not perfect. You're not going to be perfect. You're not going to be the perfect mom. You're not going to be the perfect dad. You're not going to have the perfect decorations in your home with the perfect Pinterest board. You're not, like, that's not who we are. Like, but we can make progress. We can make progress. In fact, Hebrews 12 says this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Listen, and here's the next point. Allow God in the process. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Allow God in the process, and you will make progress. You will make progress. See, sometimes like we think that Paul says, only run the race when we know we can win. That's not. He just says, run to win. Take steps, take strides, do it the best you can, train yourself, take the steps. We're all running on this race. There's things that you need to strip off your life. There's some sin that entangles us, things that aren't good for us. Take those away. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Allow God in the process, and you will make progress. When was the last time that you started your day off with a prayer that says, okay, God, we got this. Okay, God, today's yours. Okay, God, I need your help right now because I feel a little overwhelmed. God, we got a big decision to make for our family, and so we're going to come together and we're going to pray together, and you bring that before God as a family. When was the last time we allowed God in the process for our life? You know, the Apostle Paul, he says, hey, I know what I want to do, but I just keep doing the things I don't want to do. Ever been there? I know what I want, but it's like a self-sabotage. I'm doing the things I don't want. Perhaps we need to start and be honest with God, and we need to start some prayers that say, God, I'm a little over my head right now. I'm a little overwhelmed right now. God, this is harder than I thought. Adulting is harder than you thought. Retirement is harder than you thought. Parenting is harder than you thought. Marriage is harder. God, I'm on my last leg here. My marriage is hanging by a thread here. God, this is too hard and I need your help. Allow God in the process. Hebrews goes on to say in chapter 12, it says, so take a new grip with your tired hands and strengthen your weak knees. Mark out a straight path for your feet so that those who are weak and lame will not fall, but become strong. Let's become people that allow God in the process. Because you know what happens? There's a before and after work. Before we allowed God to hold the reins, and after we put God as the leader and Lord of our life. Here's a question for you to consider. What's the after picture that Jesus would shape for your life? What's the after picture that Jesus could paint for you? And are you willing to live into that picture, defining your after picture by what he would say over you, that what he thinks about you? And think about this. If we allowed God in the process, we would make progress. How could your life and your relationships be different? Your relationship with your kids, your relationship with your parents, your relationship with your in-laws, your relationships in your marriage. What after picture is hanging in the balance that is based on your ability to walk in obedience or to take steps of faith? What after picture are you neglecting because you enjoy sitting more than standing and taking steps? What after picture are you missing out on simply because of an unwillingness to take a step of faith, to walk in obedience? Imagine what your life could look like if you just completely surrendered to God. Imagine what East Point Church could look like if together, collectively, we live this way. I bet there's a bunch of us in this room that if we began just to live life in a way that we said, hey, I want to lead by serving those around me, by getting involved, by joining the dream team here at East Point, because church becomes fun when we start doing it for somebody other than ourselves. And we say, I'm gonna live my way that serves other people. I bet overnight that East Point will become better and healthier as a church. What's hanging in the balance? What after picture is hanging in the balance for you? Because of this, the big idea, everybody, we're all ending up somewhere. And very few people end up that somewhere on purpose. And we could share the stories of people that have gone before us in the scriptures, that of the move and the counter move. Move, counter move. Move, counter move. Move, oh, counter move. We could share the story after story after story of what their life looked like. And these are the details that got their life to be so significant that we read about it in scripture today. But you're also holding the pieces to your life. And you get to decide for yourself, what are the moves that you're willing to take? What step of faith, what step of obedience is God leading you to take? For some of you, that might mean for the very first time, that might mean that you're going to actually make Jesus king of your life, to make him Lord and leader of your life. And you do that in just a minute, we're going to pray, and you can just agree in prayer with me, not because prayers are magical, but because God is real and he hears them. And so for each one of us, we have a step to take, and I'm going to pray for us, and you can agree in prayer that God hears our prayer, and that then you and I, that we have the guts and the courage to walk out that step this week. That we don't sit back, that we don't neglect it, that we don't just know stuff. We know the step, but we're not willing to do it. What good is that? So let's be people that allow God in the process, and we will make progress, that we can end up somewhere on purpose. Be one of the few. Be one of the few. Let's pray together. God, I'm so grateful that you do lead us and guide us and direct our steps. Help us in these moments now that we would see you, that we would hear from you, that you would be guiding our minds to see the step that's in front of us. And God, for those of us in the room that are just choosing today for the first time to make you Lord and leader of our life, God, would we recognize you and we say, God, I've tried to move and counter move my whole life on my own, and it's led me to where I am right now, and I don't have value.
or I don't have, I feel like I have purpose. I don't know where I'm going with life. I feel like I'm wandering. God, would you begin to lead us? Forgive me, God, for the steps I've taken in all sorts of directions. But God, right now I choose to trust and follow you. God, right now, even if it's for the first time or the first time in a long time, God, I choose to trust and follow you. I want to take a step in the direction that you're leading me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you go ahead and stand with me? We're going to sing one last song, and I'd encourage you to make this song your prayer to God as we commit to be people that don't just know, but we do.
Have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains a cornerstone. Things that we thought breathing in life.
Is it working? There we go. Sorry. My name is Ryder, and I'm on staff here as the youth director. And it was just so great to be with you all this morning. Thank you for coming. And what a great word from Pastor Tony. A little joke we have, not only is his word relevant, but his outfit, the Nike Blazers, getting up here. So give it up for Tony for bringing a good word today. But we hope that what Tony had to say today, you found that helpful. And if you did find it helpful, we just want to encourage you in your next steps to just let somebody know, or just grab one of us aside if you didn't come with anybody today. And we're glad that you had a good experience here this morning. Or maybe if you've made the decision to follow Jesus for the first time in your entire life, we are so happy for you. And again, we want to encourage you to tell somebody. And if that is you, if you made that decision, we have a gift for you in the back, in the baskets. It is a First Believers package. Just comes with some tools and a Bible to get you started on your wonderful journey of following Jesus. And that's a free gift to you from us. And we just want to encourage you again in your next steps. Get involved here in the Dream Team. Let us know how we can help you out and just get involved here at East Point Church. So we're so glad that happened this morning. And then we just want to thank all of you for giving so generously here at East Point. If you'd like to give, we have a few ways that you could give up on the board. But it's because of your giving, your tithe, and your offering that we're able to have our Sunday services. We're able to have our students program and our kids' church. So we just want to thank you again for giving here to East Point. And if you want to give, you could do those ways that are up on the board. And then lastly, next week, this week is Halloween. So next week, we're going to be having a Halloween party. So we just want to ask that you will come, be ready to hang out. Kids, there'll be endless supplies of candy. And youth, we're going to shoot corn and pumpkins on the side of the church. It'd be awesome. But go ahead and invite somebody. This is going to be a great week to invite somebody, family member, friend, someone at work. And it's going to be a great time. So you guys are dismissed. The best is yet to come, and can't wait to see you next week.